Okay, so hello, this is a difficult time for speaking. Maybe sleepy, I don't know, so much is difficult. So I will try to make it quick, easy and interactive. I expect to be interrupted. So please, if you don't get anything. Well, just to be honest, I have to say that this presentation is recycled, so it is not exactly at your level. It is a little less technical than it needs to be, but we are going to make it. But then we'll look at some sources later. Okay, so sorry for my French. Yeah. And, well, how else do we begin? Now I have some good experience with functional programming, but Epsilon started essentially in 2001 after I had some experience, first with ML, then with Lisp and Haskell. And the first versions of Epsilon were strongly influenced by, particularly, the strongly typed, statically typed functional languages like ML and Haskell. Now it is moving to Lisp, and we are going to see exactly how. So the first implementation was not part of the group project, of course, and it was 2000 lines of C code, pretty easy, very standard functional language with no global definitions. So for example, to define a function, you just had to use a set of nested lets. You define a function, you say let a function be definition in the body, and in the body you could use the definition. Just that, no modules, no separate compilation, nothing. No garbage collection in particular, using a reference counter. So the implementation was not serious, it was just my second compiler, essentially a joke. The project became slightly more ambitious with the second re-implementation from scratch in 2002. And about at that time, I contacted the FreeSATO Foundation for offering GNU, offering Epsilon as a GNU project. Richard Stallman said yes, but he insisted on a condition, which I still have to satisfy, which is to make Epsilon generate also Dial code as an output, to be able to interface it with Dial extendable applications, which is actually a very good idea, but I still have to implement it, essentially because I still have to implement everything. You will soon see that I'm not the horse's better type of programmer. I'm not scared of re-implementing from scratch when needed. So the current implementation of Epsilon is the fourth one from scratch. It makes legal sense to implement Dial support now. In particular, in that time, I started to got interested in garbage collection, and now I implemented some systems and wrote a lot of stuff. And I have a general purpose garbage collector, which is nearly ready, and I'm about to publish it very soon, before Epsilon, of course. So that it can be used by other projects. I would be extremely happy to make this contribution. It is not necessarily bound to the language. So the third implementation from scratch was started in 2006. It was aborted by the policy because of some problems with separate contribution. I discovered the hard way that generating C code is not a good way for making a scalable system which can compile programs of an average set, it is simply not realistic. And generated lots of small C files and then linking them as extremely bad consequences of performance, in particular because the intercompilation unit function call must follow standard calling conventions. F conventions are slow for this. For example, they essentially prevent the recursive calls, which are essential. So my life got complicated, I moved from Italy to France for good, and I worked on ML in another free software project, even if it's not part of the GNU project. So I got quite expert with, in particular, one dialect of ML, which is called OCaml. I have something to say about it, because it's an interesting implementation. It is extremely fast, extremely efficient, and extremely correct. Even if it has roots in academia, it has an incredibly strong emphasis on efficiency. Its authors, in particular Xavier Leroy from Paris, are outstanding researchers. I've learned a lot of that from them. I like their system, but they essentially don't want to license the compiler with a GPL compatible license. They have found a consortium which provides support and essentially, in exchange for money, gives a BSD-like license to customers. But the official compiler is QPL version 1, which is incredibly inconvenient because patches, because modifications can only be distributed as patches. It is GPL incompatible, so you cannot link the GPL code. The runtime is reasonable because it's LGPL version 2 only, so it is not ideal but workable. The compiler should be replaced, I think. So I cannot declare that I want to compete against such masterpieces, but of course this is my best shot at it. And I think the language can be made better, even starting from there. The third garbage collector was an interesting intermediate step, but we don't have time to speak about it now. However, essentially no code from this implementation survives now in the current implementation. So what Epsilon is or will be, why do we need Epsilon? We need a more expressive language, because in particular, strongly typed functional languages are not extensible for the user. They lack macros. I think essentially for cultural problems, for some hostility from academia to working with syntax and allowing the user to modify it in an uncontrollable way. If I say that I want to renounce to some static checks, to some compile time checks, I'm essentially expressing doubts about the whole approach of typing languages. And this is essentially my current position. I have strong doubts about the correctness of the typed approach. Having a strongly typed language allows to catch a lot of naive errors early, but seriously castrates your expressivity. So I would like to have static types when the user wants it. So it should not be in the core language, it should be an optional part of the language, which you can enable, if possible, for some parts of the program, not for everything. I would like it to be faster than ML, which is very, very difficult, because if you talk about OCaml or also Milton in other free software implementation, this is GPL, so we can prefer it from a political point of view. They are competitive with C. They are extremely, extremely fast. But I think it is possible to do better in some cases. Hardware parallelism, multicores, SMPs are the next big thing, for real this time. So we would like to design parallelism into the language from scratch, from the beginning. And of course, the implementation will be free software, part of the GNU project, and distributed under the GNU GPL version 3 or later.
Sorry.
Yeah.
I'm a little confused. Is there a formal specification for Epsilon, the language,
no,
which you're then implementing, or creating a new language?
There is no formal specification, but it should be for previous implementations. It would have been extremely easy because it was nearly didactic interpreter. My essential mistake in the first implementations was to implement in C, which is a very bad language for compilers. Even if you made an admirable work in GCC, it is not exactly easy to maintain. But to keep the audience interested, I have to make a controversial statement. So I will find a way to pass Java before the end. So,
without the short demo.
You need a short demo about functional programming. I spoke with many people, and essentially everybody knows Lisp here. which makes me extremely happy, by the way. Well, if you want to see the short demo, I have a classic example. The classic good application of functional programming, which is computation of the derivative. Okay? Just to give you an idea. Okay. So this is the derivative written in Haskell. And, well, I don't have an Emacs mode for Haskell, unfortunately, at the moment. So we essentially say that a variable is a string, synonym type, trigger. This is a type definition. A sum type definition. So we define a type, which is called expression, by cases. An expression can be a number, a variable, a sum of two expressions, a subtraction of two expressions, a product, etc. Sine and cosine. Okay? Sine and cosine are unary, so they have only one parameter and not a pair in this case.
And the derivative function is defined case by case. So the derivative of a constant, of a number, is independently of the variable of x or y we are derivative with respect to, is always zero. Instead, the derivative of a variable, for example, the derivative of, let's say, x in x is 1, okay? If these two variables are the same. So the derivative of x with respect to x is 1. The derivative of x with respect to any different variable is this. What is it? The derivative of a sum is just the sum of the derivatives. Okay, do you understand this notation? This is essentially an abstract syntactic tree. So I'm not computing a number here, I'm just representing a tree. Okay? It's node is plus and its two children are two expressions. Okay? The language is strongly typed. Notice in particular this line. A plus contains exactly two expressions. So the type is not arbitrary here. This is not Lisp. We cannot put everything here. We have to put expressions. This makes your code very solid. If it compiles correctly, you are pretty sure that it will work. So this is 47 lines of code, including white space. And it is quite complete, working correct. I challenge anybody to do the same in Java. So functional programming is a good idea. It works. Why people don't use it? This is a frequently asked question. Happened. Okay.
I think that's what people normally
think
about.
Well, it looks different from imperative languages. And it is partially
different.
It doesn't
look different in the way that what I thought the common meaning of functional programming was. I would say that was more like a pattern matching programming.
Yes, but pattern matching is something you can obtain also in different styles. Also different languages. For example, in Lisp, we can define pattern matching support. And this is an approach I prefer, personally. The real difference in this case is not the functional approach, but the type of approach. This is strongly different from other cases. And historically, many functional language implementations have been inefficient. This is now incredibly false. It should be obvious to everybody reading the results of the benchmark. This is not. Is now false. Static typing in the example of derivative looks very useful. In some circumstances it can be a problem, for example with any program which manipulates other programs and produces some transforming version. Okay? This is very useful for compilers, for example. And if you think of the derivative example, that kind of programming is very similar to compilers. You essentially work with expressions, you modify, you produce other expressions from expressions. This is not different from working with programs. So yes, types sometimes hurt, and no, we don't have time. So what other problems have this language? They don't have macros, they don't have EVA, this is essential. So there is no way of computing a program and evaluating it at runtime. unless you reduce yourself to do ugly tricks like dumping something to the file compiler and systeming it. No? Of course, it's not realistic. ML has no read and print. I use Lisp notation because I know you understand. In Haskell, there is something similar. So Haskell is stronger from this point of view. Haddock polymorphism is not supported at all. For example, you have different plus operators for different types. You have a plus for integer and a plus written in a different way for floats. This is quite inconvenient. So your code gets very unreadable. To hinder what you are trying to express. These languages are simple compared to an imperative language like C, which is relatively big, just relatively. But they're still much too complex compared to what they should be if they were kernel-based language. My ideal model in this case is Scheme. Scheme is I'm speaking still about the fifth revision. I'm not studying yet the new standard. For Scheme Revision 5, the standard is about 70 pages, and the core language is in the first 5 or 7 pages. Okay, so all the rest of the language is built upon the first pages. This is a good way, I think, to make it something workable, because you can define essentially the majority of the language as part of the library, as a syntactic extension. we write rules as something which generates the core of language as the output. Okay? The user doesn't necessarily see the difference, but the language becomes easy to manipulate, easy to optimize, also to optimize. So this is something I would like, but it is not present in mainstream, let's say, functional languages. I would like to have the ability to add new primitive types, for example. If I want to work with fractions, like this, it's nice. Why not? And I don't have a fraction type implemented at the lower level in the standard language. I have to define it in the language. This is low. I would like to add them at a lower level, for example, in C. I would like to be able to link C code for manipulating native objects. In a sense, why the integer type is special? It should not be. It should be just a type defined by the user, if he wants. Otherwise, we can use something else, like, for example, always using big nouns instead of using register size integers. It would be reasonable in some context. I don't know. Of course, we must design a language which is built to grow, not to solve all problems. This is an old story, of course. I suggest you to read Growing Language by Steele if you don't know it. Okay, separate compilation is a problem because makes you pay an efficiency penalty for abstraction. Essentially, calling a function defined in another module costs more, is more expensive than calling a local function. This is a problem in nearly all of the implementations, except for whole program compilers like Milton. And I already hinted at the license problem of OpenAI. Okay. So this is my idea. It is still quite low, quite undefined in many details, but after 4 implementations I think that I got this right. So, the language should not be one single language, but should be layered. I should have ideally a core language, which is relatively low level, which is easy to generate machine code from. It should be untargeted, which means unsafe. It doesn't mean runtime type checking, okay, which is low. And we can always do it if we want in the definition of primitives. For example, if we wanted the operator plus checks for type correctness, we can add this feature to the definition of plus, okay, and not making the language slow only for this. So we want essentially to have an untargeted language with no continuations, no first class functions, so no lambda. No side effects. The only way of doing a conditional is a case. Of course, the Boolean, the two-way if is a particular case of this. And the language must be first order. Okay, so essentially a set of mutually recursive equations. This is very easy to manage, very easy to transform. For example, you can apply partial evaluation to this. You can make some analysis to try to have a parallel implementation. This is something I'm extremely interested in. Okay, the middle language gets translated into the core language, and it is of course a middle point, okay, a middle layer of abstraction between the high level language, the top language, which is comfortable for a user to write, and the core language, which is easy to translate. So this could be still untitled, but should be essentially more Lisp-like with first-class procedures and first-class continuations. This is useful for defining new control structures with side effects, so assignment, which can be eliminated here by making a state passing transformation, if you remember this. Still case, still user-defined primitives, and programs should be expressible as S-expressions. This allows you to manipulate them. So in particular, we should have an eval operator, probably at this level, so that we can give it runtime generating programs as parameters. The top language should generate the middle language by essentially using macros, write rules. Attributes are a different thing, and user defined primitives. So this is essentially only a set of abstraction primitives, which gives you a mean to generate code which these features, okay? So this is essentially a set of syntactic extension features, not more. It is not a separate language in that sense. We could say that many different top languages are possible. We could say maybe that in the middle between these two layers, there is the possibility of abstraction.
abstractly understand it. So I will, of course, provide my ideal language built on with these tools, but it is not the only possible top layer. You could have a different language, and it should be
nice. I don't think that having a proliferation of dialects, which is a common criticism to Scheme, is actually a problem. We can experiment. We can see the fittest survive.
How do you define side effects?
The side effects can be
intersynthesis of
No, it is not hard. It is not hard. Let's say that there are some optimizations which are not trivial, but doing a not too efficient implementation is easy. You just have to add to each function another parameter, which is a state. Okay? The implementation may also be different at the end, but you have to add the parameter, which is the state, which is also returned in an updated version. So essentially, you have to impose linearity. If you have a function which makes no signs, for example, you have lambda x dot x plus 1, this is transformed into lambda x and state is 1 dot x plus 1, which is the real result, and a new state. In this case, it's not changing to the state as well. So this can be made in a completely automatic way. It is 15 lines of code. Okay. How do we bootstrap this thing? It's not obvious. So nothing particularly big exists. I have many tests, many partial implementations of some paths, of transformations, part in ML, part in Lisp. I have a prototype Lisp system which I'm using to test the parallel features using futures. Futures are a parallelism construct, linguistic construct. Discovered by, I think, Halstead in the 70s. It's quite nice. We will see a demo if we have time. And I have a beautiful garbage collector, parallel, faster, very fast, which I will release before the language. Okay, I can show you what exists. Okay, this is not interesting, thanks. Right. So, this is NanoLisp. This is the parallelist implementation I was speaking about. Do you see? Can you read at least somewhat? The green part, let's say the green part. Okay, now I'm trying to run NanoLisp on a simple parallel program. My laptop is not the ideal machine for doing this kind of demo because it has only two processors. It is not particularly spectacular. I tested it with an 8 processors machine and it is much more fun. With only two processors in this case, I got a speed up of 1.8, which is good if you consider the facility with which I reach it. And but not particularly exciting. We can still do much more work. And let's say that this prototype has given me some important information about how to make the language more scalable. Okay, so it was Futures 3. No, this is not very interesting. Let's see this. This is simple. Okay, now I'm running another benchmark. No problem, define symbol. Aha. No. Define symbol F. Thank you. Fibonacci 2. Okay. We will be very fast. Okay, what this does? This is the typical Fibonacci function. I just write a classical non-parallel definition here. Okay? And I just computed 8 times. This was 248 processes machine. And I just sum all the results. Notice that my class is binary. This is a very, very naive implementation. Future just means compute this sub-expression in a separate thread, on a separate processor, if available, and substitute the expression, the result, with the computed result when it's when the computation terminates. So I get a ticket. I get a placeholder for the result as the result of future. But future returns immediately. So
so that I can use it in a bigger expression. For example, I could say plus of future some expression and future another expression. In this way, I created two parallel threads which compute something, and as soon as both results are ready, plus can go on and compute the sum. Okay? So the parallel model is very simple. I can make a program parallel just by adding this future annotation. Okay? So this is very clever. See, notice that synchronization is completely implicit. So this is maybe a nice way of doing parallel programming, even if it would be even better to make the compiler insert the future annotations in an automatic way. This would be extremely cool.
Okay, so the speed up in this case is 1.71, not too bad if you consider the facility. And you can also notice here some statistics about the garbage collection.
This is the Epsilon's garbage collection, okay? This is not part of this. This is what we under for the implementation. The garbage collection percentage is very low, it's very, very fast.
And you may wonder why I allocate things on the heap at all in this case, because I only work with numbers, I should not need it.
Well, this is one big inefficiency of NanoLisp. I heap allocate some data structures for representing dynamic environment. So this is an extremely big memory hog, and it destroys locality. I will get an enormous speed up by removing this. I can know this because I have already done it in part for some part of the language. With this define, with this part of conditional compiling, I'm disabling a similar optimization I did. Now, only primitive, with the demo you saw, only primitive applications, so only calling a function written in C doesn't allocate on the heap. Okay? Normal functions implemented in Lisp entail a heap allocation per call. Now I modify it. And I run the same benchmark. Now, don't look too much at scalability. Let's look at, for example, at this, at the time of the sequential gate, okay? 8.39 in the optimized case. Okay, let's go.
It should be substantially slower.
And consider that this is not the final optimization I want to do. It is much less, okay? I'm optimizing a less frequent case. So it should be, okay, it is 1061 instead of 8. So this is substantial. Of course, Epsilon will do the same. We'll never heap allocate parameters on the call. We can heap allocate at lambda evaluation time, not application time. It's much better. So you saw something about garbage collection. How many minutes do I have? At least 10. Ooh, okay. So we can also speak more details. Great. Just to start, I re-enabled the optimization.
I'm a little bit confused, actually.
Yeah.
About whether the programs you're showing us futures what?
Maybe because I used the let in this case.
That's not an epsilon program, is it? Or is it?
It is not realistic. Let's say it's not realistic because I'm computing the same thing in parallel many times, so it is obvious how to optimize.
But you're not showing us that that's what the language is going to look like, are you? You're just kind of
No, let's say that the language should look like something different. It should look like something more like this. Okay? Does it look more familiar? It is more difficult to explain, so I thought not to have much time. In this case, I have a first definition, which is the plus in the Fibonacci function, okay? It's exactly like what you saw before. Instead, in the parallel case, if the parameter is small, according to some metric, I use the sequential version. If it is not small, I just compute in parallel two subcases, and then I combine. Okay? This is more realistic. But if you think, this is a very mechanic transformation. So I don't want to write code like this by hand. I want it to be generated.
by some transformer optimizer. That is the idea.
In that example there, why is the addition of the two, the n minus 2 and the n minus 1 result, a future? I mean, you've got the two results at that point, there's no parallelism inherent there at all.
No, there's well, which line?
When you compute it, Fibonacci of n minus 2 and Fibonacci of n minus 1, so one line further down, and you're doing the addition of those as a future operation.
No,
no, that's what it looks like.
Oh, here?
Yes.
Here. Yeah. Yes, but here, this is a synchronization.
Right, so but if you go a little bit to the left of where your finger was,
of course it is another future. Of course it is not well balanced. No. Of course it is not well balanced because this operation is much slower than this.
Right.
But this is depends on the problem, of course. It is not obvious how to do better. We can do better by making some partial inline in another problem. Okay, to try to make to balance the load and do better. But no, this is a synchronization point because in this case I need this not to be futures anymore but to be numbers.
Yes.
Okay? So in this case I'm triggering two parallel computations and the calling thread sleeps, as you say.
Yes.
Okay. But so I am doing two things in parallel. Okay? So this is parallel. And consider also that recursively, each of these recursive invocation of the same function will spawn two threads in the same way. So if I have many processors, I can get them busy like this. So but with eight processors, I actually use all of them easily.
But you've got this future here, which is completely unnecessary and redundant, isn't it? You've got that's setting off one thread. That's setting off one thread.
Yes.
You've got these two values. That's a value. You're synchronized. So
you're right. You should scale also without that.
Okay. I thought there was a reason for that.
You're right. So let's see whether it is correct, should be. So now I re-enable the optimization. In my C code, this is all implemented in C, I use a lot of preprocessor macros, so it's a little slow to compile, to go primitive file, don't worry about it. Yes, it is going in parallel. Maybe you don't see it, the yellow graph here shows the processor with the use percentage, and when it is at half eight, like half height, like this is one processor. This is nearly two. Okay? So the speed up is 1.7, not too bad. Okay? So it works. You're right, that was not necessary.
But this brings on to another problem. How do you debug these programs?
It's a mess. No! parallel programs are in general very difficult to debug, but functional parallel programs are much less because if you don't consider the problem of evaluation order, you can essentially debug the sequential version and have the same semantics as the parallel version. This is an extremely big advantage compared to the imperative style. Okay? If I do exactly the same with one processor, I always get the same result. It is not by chance. It is not possible to get different results in parallel and in sequential unless the semantics of a program depends on the evaluation order. If I use future, I essentially am doing call by name instead of call by value because I am passing a parameter which is not evaluated yet. It will be evaluated in the body of the called function or maybe even later, we don't know. Okay? So the parameter passing semantics may change rapidly in this way. Okay, so.
When does the synchronization happen? Does it happen at the point when you call the plus?
At the invocation of plus.
Does it happen inside the plus when the plus works out?
It happens in the implementation of plus because plus is defined as a strict operator.
Right.
Not all operators are strict. For example, cons is not strict. It is very reasonable that cons can take two parameters which are not defined yet.
Yes.
Can, however, make a pair.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Instead, plus can't return anything reasonable.
So plus is flagged as an operation.
Yes, exactly. If you want to see the source,
right.
Yes, exactly. Primitives. Okay, so this is the implementation, which is of course very easy. I make an integer from the integer values of the parameters, but when I define it globally, I have to pass these Boolean parameters. One of them is it strict or not? Okay,
right.
And I don't remember which. If you look at cons, it should be different, in fact. So we can deduce it is the second Boolean parameter, okay? Because I see right here that cons is the different. Okay. The first parameter is the function variable or not.
So does it take a different, an arbitrary number of parameters?
I don't support it yet.
And what happens if you leave the scope where you define the features?
I leave the scope in which sense?
I mean, for example, if you create the two features inside the LED,
mm-hmm.
what happens if you leave the LED?
I don't have exceptions or continuations. I can't leave the LED. No, this is an important question. Because in some case, you may need to garbage collect running threads, which is incredibly expensive. Of course, you have whole processors which are blocked doing useless computation, which you could avoid. So this is typically a bad sign, it should not happen. Maybe it is possible to check for this condition at, how is it called? At continuation jump time. We can have a protected continuation. I don't remember the exact scheme terminology for that. A continuation barrier, is it called like that? A continuation? Well, okay. We can mark some place, and if I jump from that lexical scoping, okay, I can do something. I can register and come back to execute in that case. And I think that should be the right time to check whether some running features are still needed or not, because I can check even at runtime if somebody is waiting on the feature or not. If nobody is waiting, probably I can delete it.
So you could
use, I should think about it, I'm not sure.
So you could use a LED with an empty body as a simulation point also?
If I mark it that way, like that, not by default, of course. An empty LED does not do anything relevant. Let nothing do one swap. It does not look at features at all. For example, I can say define X to be the future of sleep 10. Not a very interesting future, but okay. Now X is not ready yet. And I can run the same let. Of course, it does not stop. X is still not evaluated because if I try to print it, it terminated because I was too late, too long, too slow. Now it blocks because it is not finished yet. I have to wait 10 seconds till it's ready. Okay, now finished. So no, if I don't use the future, I don't synchronize it. Only when I need it. Okay. Great. So, I would like to show you a very little comparative benchmark of my collector against Boehm's collector, because everybody is using that. And of course, I don't want to attack Hans Boehm, who made good work. His collector in particular is very easy to use from C. It has a more friendly interface than mine. It has many features I don't have yet. But my collector is faster and better.
Sorry, can I just ask, do you intend your collector to be usable from C as well?
Yes, but with some care. It is a non-moving collector, so it is not extremely hard to interface, but you have to explicitly mark rules, okay? That is, the unfriendly part compared to the Boehm's garbage collector, or also to Guy's garbage collector. Guy's garbage collector is very good at finding rules automatically. I can conservatively examine registers and stack. Okay, so this does have much, but not everything. For example, I may miss some static values or some global variables defined in different compilation units, stuff like that. It is always safer to explicitly mark rules. Of course, if you program in Lisp or in Epsilon, you don't need to think about it. So let's try to replace my garbage collector with Boehm's garbage collector. Let's use the same benchmark. No, let's use Waterloo. So before recompiling it, I want to time a sequential program, okay? This is a stupid benchmark computing some prime numbers. Time, now Lisp. I want POSIX style output. Okay, go. It used essentially only one processor, as you may see from the yellow graph. So, 1.40. Let's redo it. Going. Of course, the implementation of S expressions change, so I have to recompile everything. It's not by chance. One point 78 against it was 1.4. No, not dramatic. Not dramatic in this case. Let's make a bigger. Start with a bigger test case. Oh, this is not by the way the default setting of the Gwan's collector. I expanded the heap to make it competitive. Otherwise, it collects too frequently to be a fair confrontation. Maybe this is much slower, apparently. Now, if you're interested about garbage collectors internals, I will write a text info manual with also internal documentation because it's quite interesting. So I will not speak about it now. So okay, this was boring. Let's try with the epsilons collector. Notice that Poems computed a little in parallel. Poems officially supports parallel scanning, only scanning, not sweeping. But it tends not to be terribly efficient. It only got 2 seconds from being able to replace the parallel. It must also be said that in this kind of program, there is little opportunity for this kind of optimization. Because essentially all the data of the heap is dead, we only work with shortlists. So tracing is fast, sweeping is slow. 22.04, I already forgot the other number. So it was against 28, okay, we won. Not exciting. Why? Okay, because I did these settings for Boeing and essentially it worked. It worked too well. Okay. No, of course, my collector is young. I worked on it for, let's say, for three or four months, mostly last year. Okay, not now. So now I'm debugging it, but I'm not doing so seriously that. I essentially have to document it. So for Epsilon, I have still a lot of stuff to do. It is not a visible project at all for the moment, but I am ambitious and. I think there is space for doing something radically different in languages. I'm not happy at all with the current situation in languages and language research. Essentially, we rediscover stuff which was known and in common use for at least in the 70s. All the curly braces languages are absolutely nothing new. It is the usual imperative object-oriented system rehashed in some irrelevant way. Thank you.
Do you have any extra questions? I have a question.
Sure.
Alan Kay has a research project called Reinvention of Programming.
He's right.
And,
but maybe of the problems are his fault.
And his design has a layered language,
mm-hmm.
similar to your design.
I will look.
His goal is to implement a complete graphical operating system in 10,000 lines of code.
It depends on the library.
Well, from scratch. Can you imagine something like is part of your vision for Epsilon to be usable for system programming?
Let's say that for low-level programming it is definitely usable because Lisp and OCaml are usable, so that is not a problem. I'm skeptical about using it in the kernel, that is my only objection. If we have a microkernel system, then I don't see particular problems except for the microkernel itself, but maybe the microkernel is the only thing to be written in CSS. So I doubt it is the right tool. For writing a Herder translator, for example, why not? Let's do it. It's right. Of course, we need also library support, but let's say that I'm not getting too involved with the community at this stage. I want to get the design completely right before asking for help. I want to keep control of this, so my development model is more reconsidered than it was. This will change, but not now.
Okay.
Thank you again.